So now let's revisit the examples we have seen before. And the first example, we are going to actually show it in a different manner. I'll just show you what I mean. So FK plus two parallel directed edges. And when I was saying that we have a directed graph, I should have said a multigraph in general. So we allow parallel edges. So we have K plus, and each player has the same source, which is S, and the same destination, which is P. So each player needs to choose basically which edge to use. One edge costs K, the other edge costs 1 plus epsilon. And epsilon can be either a small positive number, small as we want, or zero. The different thing is that we also notice that basically if epsilon is zero, that also works. So what is that work? So, okay, the analysis is simple. The social optimum profile is, of course, when everyone uses the lower edge. And then this is also a Nash equilibrium. There is no reason to deviate into k, especially alone. So the parastability is one. Now, however, there is another equilibrium as well when everyone uses the upper edge. Now, that's the worst and the only other one, as we now show. Now, why is it the only equilibrium besides the one where everyone uses the low edge? So, there is no third option, because if both edges are used, that's the only third option. Some edge, some players use the upper, some players use the lower. Then, the fact that it's a Nash equilibrium, in particular, it means that nobody wants to move from the upper edge to the lower edge. So the share you pay at the upper edge, k times the number of players using the upper edge, is not larger than what you would pay if you move to the lower edge, and then the number of players at the lower edge are denoted from the FL, and then if you move there, it would be FL plus 1 because it's. Now, that's the condition. That's what we know because of the Nash equilibrium. In particular, that's simply by algebra that implies that if you just divide by fu plus 1, then the left-hand side becomes strictly smaller, and if you remove the 1 from fl plus 1 on the right-hand side, it becomes strictly larger. So then you can get a strict inequality here. And what it means is that now, actually, someone who uses the lower edge, and you assume someone at least one uses that, would strictly benefit from moving to the upper edge. And paying k divided by the number of users of the upper edge plus that cost. And that means that in the current profile, any user of the lower edge would strictly benefit from deviating to the upper one. And that contradicts that it's an equality. So, there can be no equilibrium when both edges are used, so the only other equilibrium is then when the upper edge is used by everyone. And the price of anarchy, therefore, is the cost of that equilibrium, which is k, divided by the cost of the best equilibrium, which is 1 plus epsilon, so it's as close as you want to k. Actually, it can be exactly k, because you can take epsilon equal to 0, and then all the calculations will still hold. So the price of money can be exactly paid. Okay, so that's one example. And on that example, we have basically seen that there can be different costs in Nash equilibrium. Here we also show that the price of anarchy is k, almost k. And what can be shown is that the price of anarchy is always the most number of players. That can be shown, and as you see in the example, it's also tied. Now, the question, of course, is what can be said about the general bound on the price of stability. In this example, it's 1, but can it be better, worse? Can it be larger than 1? In other words, can the best equilibrium be already suboptimal? And the answer is yes. And that's also an example we have seen before, the harmonic example. When you have an n player, a k player, usually plans will have n plans, but in the case of graphs, we usually denote the number of plans by k. But still, the set of plans is usually capitalized. I'm simply explaining the notation. So we have k plans, and each plan has the same, it has a sum source as player 1 source as 1 and so on till player k with source as k. And they all have the common destination. Ti for everyone is the cost drawn on the graph. And then for the social optimum, what you should do is every player should go to V, thereby paying nothing, and then go to SK and again, playing nothing, and then, excuse me, no, go to V, and not go from V to SK anymore, because the direction is the opposite. And then from V, you need to go to T, playing Y plus epsilon divided by K, a number of players. That's going to be an equilibrium, and that's, excuse me, no, that's not going to be an equilibrium, that's going to be the optimum profile. To V and then from B to T. To V and then from B to T. Okay. And social cost, of course, is just the cost of stage from B to T, which is 1 plus F. And now this is not an equilibrium. Since in this case, and actually in any case, for player K, you going to from SK to T directly is strictly dominant. Now, then, strictly dominant means that it's better than the strategy is the best, regardless whatever other thing. Because the best other option would be just using 1 plus epsilon with everyone else, and that would still be a bit more than 1 plus 1 over K. Because the epsilon here is strictly positive. Unlike in the previous example, here epsilon has to be strictly positive. So basically, okay, we have now shown that the strategy SK to T is strictly dominant for that player. Now, assume that player plays that, because in any equilibrium that has to be played, play that strategy because it's always the best. And then ask what can the others do. So delete that strategy and delete the player, assume that he plays that, or at least let's say that actually no, delete, simply assume that player plays that. And then ask what happens to the other player. But then for any other player, also for the next player, k minus 1, it's strictly better to go directly and pay 1 over k minus 1, then go into V and then pay 1 plus epsilon over k minus 1. And so on. So we fix those who we know have to play in Nash equilibrium, and then we get that they're all in Nash equilibrium, and that's actually Nash equilibrium, we can check it. Is when everyone just goes directly to T. And that costs the sum of 1 over I, which is approximately lambda, and that's called the kth harmonic number. This sum exactly that's called that's approximately lambda, but that number exactly is called the k harmonic number. And the ratio between that cost and the optimum cost, which is 1 plus epsilon, when everyone goes to V and then to this h to T, paying 1 plus epsilon together, is as close to this harmonic number as you want. It's about lambda. It's the exact supremum on this is the k harmonic number. That's the price of stability. And now what we shall show is that in general, the Nash equilibria always exist, pure equilibria. And we only talk about pure equilibria. And we are going to bound the price of stability from above. Actually, we're going to show that this k harmonic number is actually a general bound. And the example basically shows that it's high. Now, To do that, show the distance into bound that from above, we're going to use a potential function. And now we're going to define that. So let's just slowly go to define what we need. So given a profile of path in a general graph, now it's not that example, it's just a general graph. We define the function on this profile. For any profile, we define the function. First, we define a function given a profile for any HE as follows. The cost of that edge times the harmonic number of the load of that edge. You see? In the definition, we add this harmonic number. Why? You'll see that will help us to obtain some properties for the function. But in the definition, given an edge, we just look at what is the load on that edge, how many players contain that edge in their path. What is the harmonic number? That's the function of this number. What is the harmonic number of that load of that edge? Times the cost of the thing. So that's always at least what the players play for the edge, because that's always at least a cost. But it may be even more. So if the load is at least one, of course we define h for 0 to be 0. Now, finally, we define the psi. I think that function is called psi. That function is called psi. Define the psi of p as the sum of those p's for all the edge. So for any edge, we define something which is a bit above, generally speaking, then the total cost we pay for that edge and the sum. So it's a bit above of the total cost paid. But what does it give us? And so now we've proved the following nice property of the function. And that's what's called the actual property of the definition of the potential function, which we'll show later. That given any profile, if one player, exactly one player, change her strategy, then let's look at a new profile. So exactly one player has changed the strategy and the rest do what they did. Then the function changes exactly as the change in player changes her utility. So, excuse me, not exactly, but the opposite. So it's here s minus s prime, here the value at s prime minus at s. So, okay. You have a profile, you have one player exactly who changes her utility from S to S prime, from P I to P I prime, and the profile uses changes from S to S prime. So one player changes, the other players don't do anything, don't change what they keep doing what they do. The utility of the change in player, maybe the other player's utility changes too, but the utility of the changes player changes by UI S prime at the point of S prime minus UI at the point of S. And the utility of the change in player is always exactly traced up to the sign. It's exactly the opposite of the change in the psi function. Between the original, so simply I look here at what happens in the utility of the finite of the end profile minus the utility of the original profile and psi function. I look at the in the opposite direction. What happens in the original profile minus the function of the end profile? Because you can just define it as minus. It's simply a matter of sign. Unless people actually define it as a minus. I actually want to be consistent with the book. That's why I'm using the definition. So proof is simple. Defined by k, the number of players who use a given edge, the load of the edge, an edge. Now, if an edge is used in both the original and the finite path, or it's used neither in the original nor Fynet, then the status of the player does not change, and therefore the edge bears the same cost, which is the player, bears the same cost for the edge. So either it's it pays for the edge, that the K is share, or it doesn't. And the same goes for this P function. I remind you that's P, the cost, times the harmonic number, based on how on the law. Now, if the edge is used only in the first part, before the chain, then the, excuse me, then if the edge is used only before the change, and after the new path of the player, the edge is not used by that player. Maybe it's used by other players, but by that player is not used. That player, therefore, on this edge, it starts paying new cost, which is the cost of the edge, divided by the. Okay, excuse me. It stops paying. It used to pay the cost of the edge divided by original number of the. Of the law by original load of the edge, because it used to be in the PI, but it's not in the PI prime. So now it pays less. So the difference between PI prime, the utility of the player in the new profile, and the utility of the player in the original profile, is exactly that the player now in the new profile does not have to pay for that edge. Share. So the player used to pay that share. Now the player does not have to pay the share. Therefore, the utility has. 1 second. So I'm a bit confused. Is that the utility or is that the cost? Okay. Yeah, it's the utility. So the book just introduced that without mentioning, and I also didn't write myself here. So we just look at the utility as minus the cost. That's why, probably, yes, that's why the property that the gain in the utility of the deviating player is minus the change in the potential. We call this C of the potential, as you can guess. Okay, so now let's look at this proof again. So for the edges which used to be in both the original path and the new path of the player, or for edges which used to be in none, nothing changes. So either the player has to bear the same, the player has to bear the same cost, either to bear them or not to bear them. And the same goes for the psi. Now, for the psi, for the psi in this edge. Now, if the edge appeared in the original path but doesn't appear now, then the player says this cost over the number of players, or over the lot, and therefore the same, the cost means that the utility grows by the P over P. Or in other words, the difference in omega is exactly the C over T, because omega is C. What is the difference in omega? So it used to be C over some number of users, and now it's less. So exactly the change is that the number of users has decreased by one, so the harmonic number is exactly changed by y 1 over. Now, finally, it actually is used in the new path but not in the original path, then the player suddenly has to pay C over the new number of players who use the edge, which is the original number plus one. And therefore the utility basically in here, 1 second. Yeah, my apologies, a bit confusing. The utility here basically decreases, of course, by C over K, because that's the new cost incurred by the player, because now each is in the PEI prime and it needs to be paid for that amount. And that's actually the decrease in the utility. The thing is in cost, the decrease in the utility. So I need to fix that. So let's say the so the change in the change in the utility is actually minus that cost, because that's the extra cost, so that's the decrease in the utility. And then if you look at the W, that's an extra cost, so that's the increase in W. That's correct. Well, okay. That's an extra cost, so that increase in W. Or minus this cost is the decrease in W. So it works. Basically, we just look at every edge, what happens, and the linearity finishes the peak. So the change in the utility is exactly of the change of the deviating player is exactly traced by this change in the peak. And that's an important property of the function, which we are going to later call the potential function property. And now another important property which we're going to prove is that this function C is always at least a social cost, and at most HK, this harmonic number times of itself, when K is the total number of players. Remind that K is the number of players who use the compute HE, but K is the total number of players. So that's a simple thing. So as I said, the social cost is simply the sum of all the edges used in some path. I sum of the cost of those edges. At most, the sum of the cost of those edges when I multiply them by the harmonic number, which is the psi. So cost, social cost is at most. That's the cost inequality. And then C is, of course, at most, when I look at the harmonic number of the number of players instead of the number of concrete players to use the edge. K is at most K. So, okay, this is an important inequality we're going to later use for bounding the price of stability. Now, using those two lemmas, we're going to prove two theorems, but we're going to prove them in the context general potential games, which we now define. And in particular, it's going to apply for those games, but we're going to prove those lemmas for any potential game, for any finite potential game. That's that the Nash equilibria, the pure Nash equilibria, are not empty. The set of there is at least one Nash equilibria, plus that the best response dynamic can be defined, all this converges to Nash equilibria. And the second theorem is that the price of finite key is always bounded by this harmonic number of the number of players. As we've seen in the example, it's actually a tight bound. So now we need to define what a potential game is in general and define those to prove those general existence and efficiency theorems and the convergence of best response for a general game, and then they're going to show it in particularly applies to our game. So in general, given a finite game, on game players, strategies S and utilities U, an exact potential function is a function from the strategy sets, from the set of strategy profiles to R, so it's like a utility, but what the function has to be is that for any strategy profile, S, and anytime when you have some player I changing to something, You know, the new strategy profile, this player has changed from SI to SI prime, and the other players do what they used to do. So you have a unique deviator, and then the change in the potential function is exactly the opposite of the change in the utility in the unique deviator. In the utility of the unique deviator. So that this function is a potential, is an exact potential function. If it traces up to the sign, the change in the utility of the unique deviator. Therefore, the lemma above proves that actually the psi is an exact potential function for the global connection given. I'm going to try to denote the general potential function, the general gain by p. And in the global connection game, the potential will be denoted by psi. I don't promise I'll always keep the presentation, but I'll try to make it. Now, the question is, if the potential function, an exact potential function exists, is that unique? And the answer is yes, up to a constant. It needs to trace those changes, so of course you can always add a constant, but it says that it's unique. So given two exact potential for a game, there exists a constant, such that one is a constant plus another. And the proof is simple. So take any number in the any vector in this set of strategy profiles and define a function from the set of all strategy profiles to the real numbers as follows. So the function of a on a given strategy profile is going to be defined as the sum. We are looking at moving from S, this number, to this fixed number Z, and we change exactly one coordinate at each point. And we look at the difference of the utilities of the deviating players. So at any point, we use the change the coordinate of the next player from what used to be in S to what it's in Z. Now, from the definition of the potential, all those differences are equal to the difference in the potential, and that's true for both potentials by definition. And as a telescopic sum, eventually this sum, in other words, Fs, is going to be equal to Ps minus Pz, the final minus original value. But it's the same for the other potential function for Q, and therefore P is equal to Q up to a constant. So that's a simple proof on the seminal paper by Monder and Shapley from 96, where they definitely made a nice breakthrough in the area of potential games. So the next question is going to be, what about Nash equilibrium? And just a game with an exact potential function is called an exact potential game. And we are going to always talk about exact potentials unless state otherwise. So we are going to omit the word exact again, unless that happens. There are other kinds of potential, but the default is going to be exact. And there are many important potential games, and they all have important properties. So let's prove some important properties. So the first important property is that finite potential game. And I remind you that we define a game with the potential as a finite game. Again, that's how they do in the book. And I try to follow it. And I don't like it because in general, potential can be defined for any game. It's exactly this property. Function tracks the utility change of the unique deviator. And therefore, it doesn't have to be finite. But they define it for finite games, and then they can immediately say that a finite potential, a potential game has a Nash equilibrium. But in general, of course, you have to tell that a finite potential game. Specifically, given a potential function, the set of minimizers of the function are always equilibrium. Maybe there are others, but those alt-mean are always equilibrium. And in general, you need to the minimum to be attained. So it's enough that it's finite, but it does not have to be. Differential function, for example, is continuous and the set is compact. It's also fine. It's also going to end and so on. So finite potential game always has equilibrium because, of course, the function sometimes they get the minimum or attain their minimum on a finite set. So choose any S in the set of the minima, and then for any player and for any possible deviation, let's note the profile that would be created by the deviation by its prime, and then the change of player's utility would be exactly the opposite of the change of the potential function by the definition of the potential function. Now, since we took S to be the minimum or the argument, it means that the new potential function is always going to be at least as large. So this difference is going to be not non-positive, and that means that the utilities are never going to increase. So but that is the same that this F is a magic. And as I said, it's not the all, not necessarily the only one. So another thing is that consider alternating best response dynamic. So unlike what we define, any times that you start with some profile and then at any time point, everyone simultaneously or best response to what others do, what others did in the previous time step. Yeah, someone, doesn't matter who, someone who can strictly benefit from deviating, unitary deviate. And then, by definition, it's a local search in the potential function. So basically, the potential function increases because it tracks the changes. Well, when the player increases and the utility potential function decreases. And that stops if and only if when we are at an infinity. Now, since it's finite, we cannot decrease in infinity. So it implies that we stop. And then we conclude the theorem. In any finite potential game, the best response dynamic always converges to initial equilibrium. And we conclude, as a particular case, for the above, I mean, for the global. So that's the theorem we mentioned at the end of it. So for the global connection game, which is the finite potential game, there are some UI equilibria and the best response dynamics are from there. So that's what we've already proven as a particular case of this general theme for potential games. And now the question is, how can we prove this price stability bound? So that's what we've concluded already. Now the next question. Let's define a class of games which are known to be basically the same as the class of potential games, in the sense that all those games are potential, and for any potential games, there is a game of this class which has the same potential. So a congestion game, it's like a concrete instantiation of all the, of any potential game. Congestion game, it models exactly this as congestion. Consists of a player and there are resources, and for each player the strategy set is a subset of the all the subs of the resources. So the strategy set is some set, so those sets, those the possible strategies of the player are some sets of resources the player may use. Not necessarily all, but that player may use this and this, that player may use that and that. And for each resource, they're given a cost function, which depends on how many players use that, or on the law. the cost function. Of the cost of a resource depends on the load. So the load is defined by the number of players whose strategies include that resource. And then the cost of the player bears in general, the total cost, is simply the sum of all the resources that the player strategy contains, or the cost of those resources under the load, which is defined by the current strategy. So the players together build this, buy a certain set of resources, and each resource is paid according to the number of players who use it, according to this function by each player. For example, the global connection game is a particular case of a congestion. So the edges are resources. Si consists of all the Si Ti paths. So player I can choose any set of resources which consists of Tsi to Ti path. And it's edges. And the cost function of an edge is simply the cost, the number of an edge divided by the number of users. So the more players use that, the less the congestion is kind of positive. The more use, the less the cost. Sometimes the congestion can be negative. The more users are, the more the cost. The more time takes to cross them. But here it's the other way around. And it can be proven. So Rosenthal famously proved that every congestion game has a potential function. You probably will see that in the tutorial. And Mondale and Chaffetz proved that given a potential game, there exists a congestion game with the same potential. So basically, congestion games can be, as I said, isomorphic to the set of all the potential. Now, given a potential game G and its potential P, if a potential is close, it's not easy, it's if it's potential. 1 second, let me change it. If its potential is close to the social cost, then the price of anarchy is small, intuitively because minimizing the potential in an energy equilibrium. No, we don't necessarily minimize the potential in energy equilibrium, but we have an energy equilibrium which minimizes the potential. So in that energy equilibrium, if the potential, we assume it's close to the social cost, it also the social cost is close to the minimum. That's why the price of anarchy is so low. Efficiency of those Nash equilibria, which minimize the potential, is that small. But we don't know about all the Nash equilibria. And that's the problem, but for the price of anarchy, it gives us something. And the statement is formalized as follows. So, given the potential game with potential function, if there exists positive constant A and B such that, for any profit, the potential function's value is between the social cost divided by A and the social cost times B. Then the price of stability is bounded by A times B. The proof is simple. So, so let S to be a minimizer. I think it's phi. No, it's not phi. It's let. Yeah, it's phi. So let S to be a minimizer. So we are going to prove that that's actually close enough. Minimize social cost. From the above, S is an equilibrium. Now, by an assumption, now we just need to prove basically S is A times B close to the social cost, the minimizer. Now, by an assumption, the social cost of S divided by A is at most social cost of phi of S. Because that holds for any S by the sum. So S minimizes the social cost. No, let S prime minimizes, start minimizes social cost. Now, by the choice of S, S minimizes E. That's by definition, by the choice of S. Now, by the second assumption, S star, the phi of S star is at most B times social cost of S star, because that's true for any problem. Then, just concatenate those inequalities. So, social cost is at most A times E. This is the inequality. Now, A times phi at most A times S star. And A times M star is at most A times B times social cost because of that. And we have proven that the social cost of this S also Nash equilibrium, or there is a Nash equilibrium, such that its social cost is at most A B times the octet. And therefore the price of stability is at most A B. We don't know yet about the parity of Anderson, but that's the bound on the price of stability. And this kind of bound using a potential function is called the potential function method. So this theorem forms the base of the potential function method. Okay, so So having proven this potential function method, basically if the potential function is closed to the social cost function, having proven this bound of path of stability, we can basically recall that we have proven this inequality for the case of our global connection. So the A here is 1 and the B here is the harmonic number of left. And then this theorem tells us that the price of stability is at most the harmonic number of left. So we have proven that theorem we stated before. And in general, this method of potential function may give us not tight result. But in this case it's tight because for global connection games we've seen an example where it's exactly HQ. And we also notice that we apply that method also for non-atomic self-shooting. Only for the non-atomic self-shooting, also the price of Anakin stability is the same. So that then the bound was good. Okay. So the next question is as follows. Having a proven existence and having bound the price of stability, what about finding the equilibrium? You know what exists, we know that there exists at least one where the price of stability is most harmonic number of left. How can we find an equilibrium? So the theorem about the fact that the best response dynamic always converges to equilibrium gives us actually a way to find it algorithmically, but it may take too long. In general, minimizing the potential function, which is also a way to find Nash equilibrium, moreover, it's a way to find Nash equilibrium, which is this at most harmonic number of paths away from the cost, or optimum cost, it also is NP hard. So, is it maybe a hard problem? Because those ways to find probably It's aha. And actually it is ha. But in the following sense. So we now consider define a class of problems with respect to which it's going to be complete. But let's start with the polynomial local search problem. So first we define the following class, a very known class, so a generalized optimization problem. Let's say minimization, of course, the same goes for optimization, form optimization too. As instances I of problems. Now, for each instance x in I, there are instead of feasible solution f on fx, and there are cost functions cx for any s in that set of feasible solutions. So it's a function from a set of feasible solutions to R. So for each feasible solution, the function assigns the cost. And we have also a polynomial time oracle which given which basically decides the language feasible solution. Which means for any problem. So basically given a candidate for a feasible solution, decides whether it's a feasible solution or not. So we need basically that, and also we need to have an oracle that computes the cost of a feasible solution. So given an instance of the problem, so we need to find any feasible solution of the minimum cost. That's the problem of polynomial local sort. No, sorry. That's the generalized optimum problem, optimization problem. That's not the problem. So just find some. Now, local search is something else. Local search needs to have this idea of neighborhood, so that we define what it means to be local. Now, neighborhood is any subset of the feasible solution. So neighborhood, given instance X of the problem, a neighborhood of a feasible solution S for X is any subset of the feasible solutions of X. So again, for any instance X and any feasible solution, the neighborhood of S respect to X is any subset of the feasible solutions of X, and a solution S in effect, so a feasible solution is locally optimal if it's the best from the neighbor. Now, a polynomial local search problem, that's the problem we spoke about, has an oracle which decides that language. Actually, no, not exactly. It decides, given an instance and given a feasible solution for that instance, it decides whether there is something where there is something which is cheaper, or maybe not. So it tells you whether it's the best in its neighborhood. So if it is, then it's fine, it tells you. Otherwise, it tells you it's not, and it returns you something which is strictly better. It allows you to make this local search. So it's either the best, you're either done, you're local optimal, or you have an example of something better in the name. Now, assuming the polynomial best response function, if you can find polynomially the best response to what others do, find the energy equilibrium in potential games is in the set of polynomial local search, because this defines the neighborhood of a profile to be any profile. There is exactly one player who changed her strategy, and then being the best in the neighborhood means that no relative deviation is included. So the potential is locally optimum by definition if and only if the so the cost of the potential and the cost is minimum in an input instant only, no Nash equilibrium can improve, no optimum play can improve her utility by unit deviation. So, because a unit deviation, which improves, would strictly decrease the potential. It's exactly what it means that it's not local optimal. I'm talking about minimization. So, assuming the polynomial best response, when we can find this, when we always can find the polynomial time, so solution is local optimal, given an instant, and a solution we can always find whether it's the best locally or not. Because we have a polynomial best response, we can check all the local options and all the possible unit derivations and check if there is a better. We can check all the possible unit derivations and that will tell us whether it's the best among the neighborhood, among the neighbors. So this check whether it's the best, and if not, what is a best thing? Can be done by best response, and of course potential f is local optimal, so there can be no unit deviation including the potential if and only if it's an Nash equilibrium. So the problem of finding a Nash equilibrium in potential games is in this PLS. Now, only there, it's exactly the size, the complexity, hardness of PLS. What it means is that it's PLS complete. So normally, problem Q is PLS complete. There is a polynomial reduction from any PLS problem to Q. This is the local optimal for this. So anything there can be solved using Q. So every Q is not simpler than anything there, but it's there. So it's not harder to. So then Q is exactly as hard as it can get in PLS. That's the idea of PLS. So, for example, the famous weighted SAT problem is PLS complete. We don't prove to use the weighted SAT is a CNF formula. So it's a conjunction of G junctions. The junctions are CI. And each clause I of J is given with weight, non-negative. The feasible solution is any truth assignment. The cost of an assignment or solution being the total weight of the non-satisfied process. So we want to satisfy as much as possible process and pay the total weight of the non-satisfied problem. Now, in this problem, the neighbors are those who differ in exactly one variable. And the theorem is that finding an equilibrium in potential games where the best response is polynomial, that's what we know by BR is NP, is PLS complete. So we prove it exactly as hard as PLS. And now that's how we can do it. So we've shown that it's in PLS. Now so we just need to show that there is a reduction from anything in PLS there. So if we take a complete problem, that means that there is a reduction to that problem, and by transitivity, therefore, if we show a reduction from a complete, from a PLS complete problem, to find an equilibrium potential gain, it will mean that there is a reduction from any problem in PLS to find an equilibrium in potential gain. It's enough to show that there is a reduction from weighted SAT to find an equilibrium potential. Now, consider weighted SAT instances variables x, y, and the closest x, y, minus n, whose weight is w, y. W1 to Wn, respectively, and now we define a congestion game where the variables are moved to players, so they are assigned to players. So now variables x1 to xk, the game has players 1 to k, and the clauses are resources. So now the resources in the game are called c1 to cn. These are now resources. Now, a player I can add. Either by selecting all the resources corresponding from the player to choose a set, a feasible set of resources. And there are two feasible set of resources for player. Either all the resources corresponding to all the clause where you have literal xi, that corresponds to xi being assigned pole in the where it's a problem, or the player I can select. That's called fi test. That's another strategy. Another strategy. Then select all the resources corresponding to all the clauses where the negation of a literal xi, and that corresponds to xi getting true. So now a clause with ki literals is false. It can only all the elements in this junction, which contains the clause, are false, and that means that the resource has been used by k less. K have selected the resource. K false. Now, so for element j, which corresponds to clause cj, we define the cost to be 0 if less than kj plus user, and wj if exactly k plus user, kj plus. So it means that for truth assignment, when you have assignment, the potential function is exactly the sum of the cost where the q is the number of false literals in CJ. Therefore, it exactly counts those j's which are not satisfied. So, the potential function is exactly the weight of the assignment, and therefore, the equilibrium accuracy, so the minima, the minima. Yeah, okay. The local minima, in the sense that nobody can later change, decrease the potential function, correspond to the local optima of the weighted set, and that's finished the reduction. So since set is a PLS complete problem, it means that we are also PLS part, and we know it means PLS, so we are in PLS complete. So we have proven now that this problem of finding an equilibrium in potential games is PLS complete. In particular, probably there is no solution to polynomial, because if there were, there would be a solution for a polynomial solution for anything that is PLS complete, and we don't know that. Quite many problems. Okay, so we are almost done with this topic, and see you on the next one.